Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Greater Houston Partnership's 2016 State of the Port. Please welcome the President and CEO of the Greater Houston Partnership, Bob Harvey.
Good afternoon. I'm Bob Harvey, President and CEO of the Greater Houston Partnership, and welcome to this afternoon's event. You know, it's my pleasure to welcome you as we celebrate and dedicate our focus to one of the region's key economic drivers, that being, of course, the Port of Houston. As usual, the Port of Houston continues to drive the growth of the Greater Houston region. In fact, year to date, the port's total tonnage is up 4%. And we know that strong container volumes continue at a steady pace, and the Port of Houston Authority is expecting another record year in container volume. And the Port of Houston is without a doubt one of our key assets in the region. So you must know by now that the Port of Houston is the number one port in volume of foreign tonnage, and we have been for 20 consecutive years. Yep. And of course, that has contributed to Houston becoming one of the global logistics centers truly operating at a world-class level. Of course, more recently, the continued investment in refining and petrochemical industries along the ship channel has driven even more growth in employment, more economic activity, despite the broader downturn in the energy economy. And also quite recently, the expansion of the Panama Canal has increased traffic, created the opportunity for greater efficiencies using larger ships, and again, positioned Houston as a key hub in the global logistics chain. So we couldn't be the city that we are, we couldn't be the region that we are without the Port of Houston as an institution and all those other companies and individuals that make our port an economic center of activity. I'd like to turn your attention just to a moment to a video that will acknowledge today's generous sponsors for this event.
Ladies and gentlemen, the generous support of our members is essential to the success of the Greater Houston Partnership and our work of making the Houston region greater. Please join us in thanking. Today's State of the Port Waterway sponsor is BB&T. Today's Maritime sponsors are AECOM and Gehagon and Bryant Associates, Dannenbaum Engineering Corporation, ExxonMobil Corporation, Greenberg Trawrig LLP, Intercontinental Terminals Company, LLC, Shell Oil Company. Our cargo level sponsors are Allegiance Bank, BBVA Compass, Brown & Gay Engineers, Inc., Centerpoint Energy, X Cargo Service, Inc., Houston First Corporation, Houston Pilot, Reliant and NRG Company, RPS Klotz Associates, Schrader Engineering, Wells Fargo. Photography underwriter is Enterprise Products Operating, LLC. Also thanks to our staging partner, LD Systems, and our production partner, Vision Production Group. The Greater Houston Partnership would like to express our sincere appreciation to the members of Houston's Consular Corps for everything they do to establish positive foreign relations between the Houston region and their respective countries. Their leadership is invaluable to building and maintaining the region's key international relationships. The Greater Houston Partnership would also like to acknowledge our elected officials, the men and women who represent Houston at the local, state, and federal level, for their work to improve our region. Please join us in thanking all of our sponsors, members of the Consular Corps, and our elected officials.
Again, thank you to our sponsors. I do want to recognize and call out our elected officials a bit more than was just done in the videotape. And today's, I think, a day where we can all appreciate the tough job it is to be an elected official and the vital role they play as public servants in our region. So what I'd like to ask is that the elected officials stand up when I call your name and remain standing. We'll do this by group, and then we'll sit down and introduce the next group. Of course, I want to start with a group of appointed officials, those being the Port of Houston commissioners, and let me read their names, beginning with, of course, the chair, Janiece Longoria, Theldon Branch III. Why don't you, would you all stand as I give your names? Theldon Branch III, Dean Corgi, Stephen Don Carlos, also as Mayor of Baytown, Clyde Fitzgerald, Roy Meese, and John Kennedy. Let's recognize this group of Port of Houston commissioners. I believe we have just one member of our federal congressional delegation who's here, so Congressman Randy Weber. Randy, thank you. We have an individual who has a previous title and a new title, so I'll just bring it all together. State Senator Rodney Ellis, Commissioner-elect. Rodney, are you here? Thank you. And we have just one member of City Council, Michael Kubosch. Michael, would you stand? Thank you. And we have several elected officials from regional cities, and so I'd like to introduce them as a group. City of Clear Lake Shores, Amanda Fenwick. City of LaPorte, Mayor Lewis Rigby. And Galveston County Commissioner Kenneth Clark. And I'll add, let's just recognize that group. That's great. Thank you. From Harris County, we have two elected officials, County Attorney Vince Ryan. Vince, yes, and County Clerk Chris Daniel. Chris, are you here? There you are. Chris, there you are. Oh, and I'm sorry, I missed earlier. The Mayor of Spring Valley Village, Tom Ramsey. Tom, would you stand and be recognized? Great. Thank you. Now, I'd also like the Consular Corps that's here today, and I saw quite a few as I came in. Would all of the members of the Consular Corps simply stand and let us recognize you as a group? Thank you, Philip. Thank you. Great. And it's, you know, at a setting like this, and I want to say there is no better group of advocates for this region than our Consular Corps, the third largest in the nation. They represent us so well back to their home countries and their countries so well here. So we appreciate very much what you all do. I'd also like to recognize the members of the board of the Greater Houston Partnership that are here. Would all the members of the board of the Greater Houston Partnership stand and let me recognize you? I see Tony, but he's, okay, great. Jim, thank you. Thank you, Dan, appreciate it. Now, it's time for lunch. I say that as you put the next bite in your mouths. It's time for lunch. Following a brief intermission, Tony Chase, who's a former chair of the partnership, and of course he's chairman and CEO of Chase Source, he'll come forward to introduce our keynote speaker, Janiece Longoria. So enjoy your lunch. We'll resume the program in just about 15 minutes. Thank you very much.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Tony Chase, Chairman and CEO of Chase Source.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Tony Chase, and I'm the Chairman and CEO of Chase Source. I'm also a board member and former chair of the Greater Houston Partnership. I'm excited to be here with you today, and it's my pleasure to introduce a dear friend, Janiece Longoria, chairman of the Port Commission and the Port of Houston Authority, the leading economic engine for the Greater Houston region. The port has long been one of Houston's crown jewels and has risen to new heights under Janiece's leadership. I've known Janiece and her husband, Steve, for many years, and I'm honored to have the opportunity to introduce her today. Janiece was unanimously approved by the city and the county on January 8, 2013, to be the new chair of the Port of Houston Authority. She also chairs the Port's Audit Committee and serves on the Governance and Pension and Benefits Committees. She's also created the Citizens Advisory Council to foster open communication between the Port, in and around the Port of Houston and the Port Authority. She serves on the board of two public companies, CenterPoint Energy and Superior Energy Services, both based in Houston. She's the former vice chairman of the UT System Board of Regents, and as I understand, the new president-elect of the Texas Exes, and a former board member of the UTEMCO, University of Texas Investment Management Company. She's also active in many nonprofit organizations and currently serves on the board of directors of the University of Texas Law School Foundation, our own Greater Houston Partnership, the Texas Medical Center, and the board of visitors at the UT MD Anderson Cancer Center. Janiece has received numerous honors and recognitions for her community and board service, including receiving the Distinguished Alumnus Award at the University of Texas, the Sandra Day O'Connor Award for Board Excellence, the Female Executive of the Year Award from the Houston Hispanic Chamber, and she's also been recognized as a breakthrough woman. I'm not quite sure what that is, but that's pretty wonderful. And inducted into the Hall of Fame by the Greater Houston Women's Chamber of Commerce. Before I go any further, I'd like for you to watch a short video clip with me about Janiece.
Everything about the Port of Houston exudes energy, growth, expansion. We are ready with four new Superpost Panamax cranes, now installed at Barber's Cut Container Terminal. These new ship-to-shore cranes are ready for the Superpost Panamax vessels that are headed our way, now that the expansion of the Panama Canal is complete. Last year, the four new ship-to-shore cranes made their way from South Korea around the Cape of Good Hope. After 77 days and some 16,000 nautical miles, the cranes, each towering nearly 30 stories high, arrived. Now they're ready. Ready to load and unload Super Post Panamax vessels. Three new cranes will be installed at Barber's Cut in 2017. It's the next step in the Port of Houston's continued growth and expansion. Our new strategic plan was approved by Port Commissioners last year. It includes major infrastructure improvements. Among them is our $700 million upgrade of Barber's Cut Terminal. We are dredging our channel deeper and wider. We continue to enlarge the berthing areas and container yards for greater capacity, strength, and efficiency. They're the latest example of how our investment continues. See what we've done at the Turning Basin? Wharves 32 and 33 are now specially designed for project and heavy lift cargoes. With load capacity of 1,000 pounds per square foot and 20 acres of newly paved marshalling area, these wharves offer plenty of space for all types of project cargoes. Our expanded container facilities prepare us for greater cargo volume. And we are working to expand our capacity for refrigerated cargo as well. We made history in 2002 as the first U.S. port to receive an ISO 14001 certificate for environmental compliance, resource protection, and conservation. And we have just become the first port in the world to meet the latest ISO standards for environmental management. One example is our use of dredged material to restore marine habitats for aquatic life and birds. We are ready for bigger things to come.
Please welcome our chairman, Janiece Longoria.
Thank you so much. I love the energy in this room. I'm so thrilled to be with great friends of the Port of Houston. Thank you for being here today. And Tony, thank you for that very kind introduction. And thank you, Bob Harvey and Susan Osamakis. I apologize, I'm losing my microphone here. Thank you for including us today. We're always thrilled to have an opportunity to address a crowd of this importance. You know, have you ever left anyone speechless? Well, it's hard to believe it's been a year since I delivered good news at the State of the Port in 2015. It was October 30th. And to tell you the story about how I left someone speechless, I drove from the State of the Port in 2015 to Conroe to replace a large tree that my husband and Steve Lasher and I had lost in our front yard. It was a large oak with a 24-inch diameter trunk. And I was very sad about losing it, so I went to the tree farm and I selected a lovely 30-foot cathedral live oak with an 8-inch trunk, one-third the size of what I had lost. Now, this decision to purchase a tree that was one-third the size of what I had lost was driven by the sheer difficulty of moving and planting a large tree. And secondly, of course, cost. Well, lo and behold, the day arrived for my tree to be delivered and planted, and it was horizontal on a flatbed of a semi-tractor trailer parked at my front curb, ready for planting. My husband happened to come home early that day, and of course, he was greeted by a crew of tree specialists and a flatbed tractor trailer with a 30-foot tree. So he comes over to me and he says, "Janiece, what's going on here?" I said, "Honey, I'm replacing that tree that we lost." And he says, "Janiece, are you crazy? Do you think we're made of money?" I said, "Steve, if I thought we were made of money, I would have bought a bigger tree." So now on to the State of the Port. As I've said many times, at the Port of Houston, we're all about partnership, Bob, innovation, and service. And you're going to hear more about that today. Of course, some of our most important partners and members of our very successful team are our Port Commission. So please join me in recognizing our commission, including Commissioner John Kennedy, Dean Corgi, Clyde Fitzgerald, Stephen Don Carlos, and Roy Meese. Please stand so that we can give you a hand. These commissioners are volunteers and donate their time without pay to ensure that the Port Authority continues to drive regional and state prosperity. Commissioners, thank you for being here. And as always, I appreciate your dedication to the mission and to our very important institution. Now, in 2015, we approved a strategic plan with very thoughtful input from the entire commission, our staff, and our stakeholders. Many of you are here in this room. And the Port of Houston's mission is to drive, move the world and drive regional prosperity. And we did that in 2015, we're doing that today. Since 2011, we have created another 148,000 jobs. And we continue to implement action plans that will drive success through commitment to our mission, and to our vision and core values. We have worked to assure that there's a very strong alignment between who we say we are and what we do. We demonstrate our commitment as ambassadors of the Port of Houston to everyone that we meet. Now, the four strategic goals that are in that plan that achieve the mission include people and organization, infrastructure, stewardship, and growth. I will cover each area briefly today. But before I get there, let me place this in context.
There's no doubt that the Port of Houston is a significant economic driver for our region and our state, as you heard from Bob Harvey earlier. Our public and private marine terminals annually generate economic impact of over $265 billion, which is 16% of the state's gross domestic product. This is a remarkable statistic. And since 2011, this has grown by more than 46%. Now, with the exception of steel, demand for which, of course, has been dampened by the downturn in oil and gas production, 2015 was a record year for the Port of Houston Authority. Container throughput was up 9%, operating revenue grew by 11%, operating income was up by 44%, and net income rose by 19%. The cash flow that is used to fund infrastructure improvements at our facilities was up by 12%. And let's not forget what drives these results. The Port of Houston Authority serves a thriving region with a comparatively robust economy in spite of the downturn in oil and gas prices. Houston, of course, has grown to be the fourth largest U.S. metropolitan area in the country with 6.1 million residents today, due in great part to the industry and commerce that flows through the Houston Ship Channel. And of course, our population growth is projected to continue to rise sharply. And the unincorporated areas of Harris County, they continue to outpace Houston in population growth. Our population regionally is expected to grow another 9.2% in just the next 5 years. We at the Port of Houston are deeply committed to continue to be a driver of this growth and to serve a fast-growing population. So let's review how we will continue our momentum through 2016 and into the future. First of all, and Bob, this is music to your ears, partnership is essential to success in any enterprise. And then thinking more about that, the bedrock of that success comes from the people that work every day to accomplish the mission. So that's the first strategic goal that I would like to cover. It's the women and the men at the Port of Houston Authority that work every day to keep our operations running smoothly, efficiently, and most importantly, safely. Our staff is led by our Chief Executive Officer, Roger Gunther. Roger has done an excellent job with our strategic plan, aligning our goals with that plan and getting everybody on board. For our people and organization, our employee goals are tied to the strategic plan. Roger has developed a very good internal communications plan, and he works daily to increase employee engagement. We also support a very successful intern program at the Port of Houston to assure that future jobs, as they come available, can be filled from our region. Roger continues to keep dedicated people in the pipeline so that we have a workforce for the future that will be ready for our challenges ahead. Information technology, a very important element of our plan. Staff is close to completing, under his supervision, a new information technology plan, which is good news as we're constantly reviewing, analyzing, and improving our platform to assure that we continue to be best in class in serving our customers and the maritime industry. Roger, as the leader of our talented staff, please rise so we can give you a hand. We have a stellar staff and organization. Now to stewardship. We believe in responsible stewardship of our resources and our environment. We believe it's important to balance our growing business with sustainable environmental practices. We're internationally recognized, as you saw from the video, and we're an environmental leader among top-ranked ports. We were the first U.S. port to achieve ISO 14001 compliance for environmental management. And of course, we've made history again by being the first port in the world to meet the new 2015 rigorous ISO standards. We use environmental management system as a cornerstone of our business decisions, and we integrate environmental performance in our organization's strategic planning. We also utilize LEED standards where feasible at our facilities. And as you saw in the video, we utilize dredged material for beneficial uses, including the construction of marshes and wildlife habitat. Safety. Safety of our workforce is in our DNA. We are constantly assessing and improving our approach to safety. We have facilitated over 1,000 safety audits and have focused on prevention. We've conducted over 1,500 training hours for our employees. We have decreased the incident rate by approximately 30%. And we've conducted the DuPont Safety Survey with a 98% response rate to achieve best practices at our facilities. Now on to cybersecurity, which of course is a hot topic at companies around the world, and certainly a hot topic during the last election cycle. We are vigilantly and proactively mitigating increasing threats to our cybersecurity system. We recognize that a compromised maritime logistics chain could cause significant and costly consequences for all of us in this room. We are a leader in best practices as we partner with the Department of Homeland Security and the United States Coast Guard. And to further strengthen our system and practices, the Port of Houston Authority was recently awarded a port security grant to conduct cyber assessments and hardening of our systems. We continually review, assess, and harden all of our systems, including cybersecurity. Maritime education, very important to us now and for our future. We invest in maritime education for future workforce needs to assure that we are America's distribution hub for the next generation. This is important as more than 50% of our maritime workers are over 50 and nearing retirement. We continue to invest in maritime education to prepare the next generation for the growing career opportunities in very good paying jobs in maritime fields. Through partnerships with local high schools, four-year colleges, and junior colleges, our students have the opportunity to participate in programs intended to prepare them for these important maritime careers. Examples of our success in these initiatives include that we've had 472 students graduate from the Maritime Academy High School programs, and we have 1,000 students in the pipeline. Over 300 students attend our Youth Expo every year. We sponsor a magnet school for maritime education within the Houston Independent School System. Our entire commission and our entire staff is very deeply committed to these maritime education and internship initiatives that make us better and stronger and that spread opportunity through our local communities. Our next strategic goal is infrastructure. All of you are aware that continued investment in infrastructure is vitally important to the continued success of our port and continued economic development for our entire region. First and foremost, we have to keep ahead of growing demand. And as you saw, that's growing very rapidly. And we also must be very efficient in the deployment of our resources. Our Houston Ship Channel is the busiest waterway in the nation with more than 9,000 vessel calls per year. If you consider that some of those vessels have more than one stop and there's two-way traffic, that's more than 20,000 ship moves in our channel every year. That's more than five times that of LA Long Beach and four times that of New York, New Jersey. Thanks to the partnership between the Coast Guard, the Houston Pilots Association, the Harbor Tugs, Port of Houston, and our firefighters and other industry partners, many of you are in the room, incidents are kept to a minimum. And when they occur, they are mitigated very quickly and effectively. As an example, on September the 9th, the Upper Houston Ship Channel was closed because of a bunker fuel spill and fire from the MT Aframax, an 810-foot tanker. Port Authority dispatch received reports that both the water and the ship were on fire, And our very own fireboats 1 and 2 responded very quickly to the call and saved several vessels moored nearby, as well as several docks. We are so grateful to our firefighting team and their quick response to what could have been a terrible incident. And of course, the lifeblood of our operations, the Houston Ship Channel, and our terminal channels require constant attention to assure that we don't lose our competitive advantage. We finished dredging the Barber's Cut Terminal Channel from 40 to 45 feet to match the depth of the Houston Ship Channel, and we are nearing completion at Bayport. This will assure that we're ready for the larger ships that will be coming through the Panama Canal. Although this is a federal obligation, we didn't have the luxury of waiting 15 years for the federal government to approve this funding obligation. So that $80 million, that dredging project has been 100% funded by the Port of Houston Authority to ensure that no cargo opportunity is lost for our region. Again, this demonstrates our very deep commitment to creating and sustaining jobs for our region. We are continuing to invest in our 2 container terminals at Barber's Cut and Bayport. Our container operations comprise a substantial piece of our overall operating revenue. Barber's Cut, it first opened in 1977, nearing 40 years old. So we're modernizing and improving it. We will be investing an additional $350 million at Barber's Cut over the next 5 years to assure that that facility remains productive. The goal of the reconstruction is to increase efficiency, facilitate larger vessels, and double the container handling capacity of that terminal in its existing footprint. And our efforts are almost complete. We took delivery last year of 4 new Superpost Panamax wharf cranes at Barber's Cut, and 3 additional cranes for Barber's Cut are under construction and scheduled for delivery in May of 2017. And at Bayport, we continue to build according to demand. Expansion of container laydown areas are being constructed to increase storage capacity. Additional container yard and wharf expansion projects are also in the works, including on Wharf 2. 3 additional state-of-the-art ship-to-shore cranes are under construction for Bayport and are scheduled for delivery in 2018. It's also important that we continue to invest in our general cargo facilities at the Turning Basin. We are ranked as the leading break bulk port in the nation, and break bulk comprises about 20% of our revenue. Some of the investments that were that are happening at the Turning Basin include phased wharf redevelopment and road improvements. For example, we enhanced High Level Road, which is the entry to our general cargo facility at the Turning Basin. We did that to increase efficiency for delivering break bulk and project cargo. And we've also added more laydown space near our wharf for heavy lift cargo for supersized industrial projects. It's also vitally important that we continue investments that increase the velocity of handling cargo and makes us more efficient in our operations. That helps us attract new cargo opportunities. I've often said that what sets us apart from our competition is not only the stellar quality of our infrastructure, but our innovation and our customer service. We have state-of-the-art truck gates at our facilities to increase velocity, the efficiency of the supply chain, and to reduce truck turn time and emissions. We use optical character recognition at the truck gates, which reads the chassis number of the truck and allows virtually seamless and speedy check-in for truck drivers picking up or delivering containers at our terminals. We've also created a bilingual mobile application for truckers that allows them to check the status of the container they need to retrieve so that there's no wait time and a reduction in emissions. And of course, we've extended gate hours in 2016 and we'll extend them again in 2017 to stay ahead of the demand curve. This is the reason we at our facilities are able to move an average of 3,000 trucks in a single day at either one of our container facilities. Last year, we processed more than 4,300 trucks at Bayport in a single day without any congestion or wait time, and I think that deserves a little bit of a hand. Our final, the final thing that I would like to talk about is growth. I want to talk about how we will continue the momentum and our growth through 2016 and beyond. We continue to expand, but we're doing it strategically. Now, the primary driver for our future is container traffic, both import and export, which currently is 70% of our operating revenue. We're the leading Gulf Coast port for container traffic, and we capture 70% of loaded container volume on the Gulf Coast. In spite of the downturn in oil and gas, container activity this year remains steady. 2015 was a record year for containers, and for the first time in our history, we reached the 2 million TEU mark. In 2016, through September, we are on track and have processed more than 1.6 million loaded TEUs through our container terminals. More importantly, container operating revenue is up by 5% as compared to this same time last year. We expect this positive trend to continue through the remainder of the year. And it's also very important that we continue to look for other opportunities and develop and diversify our business. We are the International Port of Texas and the busiest container port on the Gulf Coast. We reach 144 million consumers within 1,000 miles of our port. And our unparalleled customer service, innovation, and our supply chain certainty drive additional business to the Port of Houston. And of course, with expected population growth, we're going to attract additional cargo. So it's important that we not rest on our laurels and we continue to proactively develop and diversify our business lines. Our business development has been successful in the areas of refrigerated cargo, real estate, all water carrier services from Asia through the Panama Canal, and growing exports of petroleum products by container, including synthetic resins. Let me just briefly cover each one of those. First, as to refrigerated cargo, we continue to pursue the development of refrigerated transload facilities with ready access to our Bayport container terminal. This is important not only to diversify our business, but also to serve our growing consumer base. This initiative will attract new chilled commodity imports, including fresh produce. This is truly a win-win for our region, bringing fresh and less expensive produce to our consumer base while creating additional good-paying jobs in corollary areas such as warehousing, distribution, and logistics. Federal Trade Zone number 84. Our Foreign Trade Zone number 84 is the top-ranked U.S. trade zone in terms of total merchandise receipts. We had a record year in 2015 with 10 new authorizations, and we're going to beat that record this year with 11 new authorizations. According to the FTZ board report to Congress, FTZ number 84 was responsible for over 1,600 new jobs in 2015, and more than 3,500 new jobs have been added in that trade zone since January of 2016. Real estate. It's important to optimize and leverage our real estate assets. Recently, we announced that Enterprise Products Partners had broken ground on a new ethane manufacturing and export facility. As of September 1st, Enterprise is in service, and the MVJS Ineos Intrepid, now that's a mouthful, set sail with the first cargo of ethane export from that facility at Morgan's Point. By the end of the year, we anticipate that that facility will be exporting roughly 1.9 million barrels per month. This further illustrates the importance and the impact of the shale energy renaissance with this productive facility at our Port of Houston. Frontier Logistics, their resin warehouse complex and rail yard development on North L Street has broken ground. Oil tanking, recently acquired by Enterprise, has also started construction of a new tank farm on a portion of the Port Authority's Beltway 8 property. Freight Station Road is complete. It opens the south portion of the Bayport Container Terminal for additional business. And I'm proud to report that we have negotiated a lease with an auto processing company for the movement of rolling stock through our terminal. Auto Warehousing Company of Tacoma, Washington recently announced that it has signed a lease with the Port of Houston Authority for a new automotive terminal located at Bayport for an initial 3-year term. This lease will allow AWC to discharge new vehicles and perform accessory work for a new automobile distribution business in our region, which is great news. If this continues, and we hope that it will, it is a great repurposing of the facility that was initially constructed for cruise business. That deserves a round of applause. Roger, thank you to you and your staff for having kept your eye on that ball and getting that done. We really appreciate it. Resin. More evidence of important impacts from the shale renaissance on the Gulf Coast includes the manufacturing of synthetic resins. Synthetic resin bagging facilities and exports through our port continue to expand very rapidly. Petrochemical resins are a major export to Asia, to Europe, to the Americas for the manufacture of consumer goods. There's no doubt that much of the finished product might well come back across our docks as imports bound for retail outlets, so we benefit from that commodity in both directions. Shippers and ocean carriers. Our commercial division has been very successful in developing all water service from Asia. It is remarkable that just 12 years ago, we had zero business coming through the Panama Canal from Asia. Today, just 12 years later, it comprises 28% of our container trade. Maersk Line, Mediterranean Shipping Company, began operating a new direct all-water container service between the U.S. Gulf and Asia in April, with the Port of Houston as the first inbound port of call. This alliance enhances existing weekly Asian services operated by CMA, CGM, and Costco. Additionally, the first regular direct container ro-ro service between Houston and West Africa was launched by Grimaldi in February of this year. And the recent delivery of thousands of cartons of oranges from South Africa highlights the third season of importing South African citrus to Houston. Our port is the only port in the southern United States approved by the Agriculture Department for this commodity. So we are continually working to attract other services and cargo, and we are very grateful to our commercial division for the work that they do to attract new business to our port. Thank you. We also work hard to attract cargo-related conferences to our great port region. In June, we hosted the inaugural Journal of Commerce Gulf Shipping Conference. This conference is again scheduled for May of 2017 and enjoys growing interest from the container industry. And thanks to Roger Gunther's efforts and his idea, the Port of Houston Authority also held its first annual Plastic Resin Symposium for selected shippers, packers, and carriers associated with the wave of resin and plastics exports that I just described earlier. This conference allows the petrochemical industry leaders and port officials to talk about ways to improve efficiencies. And for the second year, we hosted the FTZ number 84 conference, which has also grown significantly. That conference allows current users and potential FTZ users the opportunity to learn about this very important economic tool. The centerpiece of our conference efforts is the Breakbulk Americas Conference. And so we're very proud to report to you that in late September, we hosted the 27th annual Breakbulk Americas Conference at the George R. Brown Convention Center. There were 5,000 attendees and 355 exhibitors. They showcased the world's major carriers, maritime industry equipment manufacturers, freight forwarders, and ports from all over the world, making it one of the largest maritime transportation trade shows in the world. This conference had an estimated economic impact of over $3.2 million in the 3 days that it was held at the George R. Brown. Because we lead the nation in break bulk cargo, we have been able to attract this conference to Houston since 2012. And we've been informed by the conference organizers that they're going to continue to hold it in Houston in future years. We are very proud of this important contribution to our local economy. Importantly, the topic of freight mobility is also on everyone's mind, and I'm sure everyone in this room. What you have heard today assures very significant and rapid growth, which is both a blessing and a challenge. A blessing because it creates and sustains jobs and economic activity for our region. A challenge, of course, because of the growing congestion in freight mobility and on our roads. Open and fluid access to road, highway, and rail networks are critical to our success and to the success of our region. We're very proactively addressing all intermodal forms of freight traffic, including enhancing our rail network, road and connector efficiencies through the Texas Department of Transportation, trucking solutions, freight shuttle potential, and other innovations that could help to reduce congestion and emissions. And we've been very responsive to local mobility concerns, which is another reason that we are extending our operating hours at our container terminals to 11 p.m. in 2017. Although this is going to require additional capital spend for headcount and for customs and border protection services, it's important to meet growing demand to our industry customers and to spread, hopefully, freight traffic away from commuters during congested times of day. As a final note, and I'm so grateful that you're all here today, our mission and our vision is accomplished through the synchronicity of not just a strong team, but a team of teams. They include our labor, the men and women on our docks and on our seafaring vessels, the Houston pilots, the shippers and their selected ocean carriers that continue to call on our port, our federal partners, including the U.S. Coast Guard, U.S. Customs and Border Protection, and our community and environmental partners. And we count on every one of you to support us in our mission as we continue to move the world and drive regional prosperity and our vision to be America's distribution hub for the next generation. Your support is critical to our success. Now, all of you know that I'm an optimist, and I always will be. Last year, at the end of my State of the Port, I read The Optimist's Creed by Christian Larson. I did that because poetically it happened to have been written at the same time that the Houston Ship Channel was opened. This year, I will simply say that I live those words of optimism. Every day is a blessing, and every day is the best day of the year. And as I've heard it said, shoot for the moon, and if you miss, you will still be among the stars. Our extraordinary team of teams will always shoot for the moon. And with your continued support, we can reach any goal in our collective vision. Thank you very much.
Let me just wrap up with a couple of announcements. Let's start by thanking Janiece, thanking the commission, and thanking the staff for this great event. You know, I want to say that we're so proud to host the State of the Port each year, and there is so much happening at the port. I feel like we hear about a different port every year with this incredibly dynamic structure. Let me mention three other events coming up before the end of the year. State of Energy, Ryan Lance, Chairman and CEO of ConocoPhillips, will be speaking on November 17th at the partnership's third annual State of Energy. We have State of Texas Medical Center with Bobby Robbins and a panel of other distinguished visitors, December 1st. And finally, the Houston Region Economic Outlook. We'll have the chief economist of the American Chemistry Council, and of course, our own Patrick Jankowski will present his jobs forecast for 2017. That's on December 9th. So I look forward to seeing you at these other events. Thank you all for being here today. See you. Have a great week.